And this is the fourth of Bob's books. And for those of you who've read any of the others, I think you will agree with me that they're all insightful and provocative. And Bob does a hell of a job, and I'm sure he's going to do the same thing with these. And in particular, I'm sure he's going to pick on two or three of my favorite liberal icons. So with that, I'll give you Bob.
Thank you, Mike. I can't thank Mike and Ramey enough for this wonderful occasion. People sometimes ask me, and they ask other authors, why do you do this? Why do you write these books? And secretly, you never really answer truthfully, but secretly, it's because you're hoping to get rich and famous. But it doesn't ever happen. So I usually have something, you know, I've got something to say, and I try to make it very literary and emotional, but my secret reason is so I can have parties like this. And so it's really quite wonderful. I'm not going to talk very much about this book. It's a book about how presidents fail and succeed and how we assess their performance. And I got into it because I got a call from an editor, he's no longer there, at the New York Times op-ed page, who wanted to know if I wanted to write a piece about a remarkable statement by our president, Barack Obama, who told Diane Sawyer, I'd rather be a really good one-term president than a mediocre two-term president. And he said, maybe you could talk about some of our, you know, good one-term presidents, like William Howard Taft. I mean, I said, I'd love to write this piece, but what I really want to do is talk about how the historians judge presidents and how the electorate, the contemporaneous judgment of the electorate, emerges on these presidents and do a comparison. And the piece was really about how they overlap, which basically said that what Barack Obama said was essentially nonsensical, because most likely if you're a one-term president, you're not going to go down in history as a really good one-term president. You're going to go down in history as a mediocre one-term president, and if you get two terms, you may have a chance to be a really good two-term president. So I wrote that piece, and then in the course of sort of looking into it more than I really understood at the time, I realized that there are certain instances where there are some rather significant disparities. I said, well, that's fascinating. Well, historians are quite different from the contemporaneous judgment of the electorate, and that's fodder for conversation. So I tried to write a conversational book, and I'm going to read just a little tiny bit of it from the introduction to give you a sense of what I was trying to do, and also a sense of how much I really revere the institution of the presidency. I think it really is a work of genius for the ages. In embarking upon my exploration of the presidency, I confess to one prejudice. I consider the institution to be a work of genius. So I guess I forgot I said that. A unique governmental institution that contains within it centuries of civic experimentation, armed struggle, historical exploration, penetrating political analysis, and philosophical endeavor. It all came together almost by accident during that miraculous building session in Philadelphia during the hot summer of 1787. Both George Washington and James Madison used the word miracle in letters to describe the outcome. It isn't surprising that the American people take a proprietary view of their presidential office and demand from it an appropriate degree of dignity and solemnity and success. It's difficult for us today, with 225 years of constitutional history at our backs, to conceive what a remarkably innovative and novel idea the presidency was. The great kings of the world are long gone now, but in the 18th century, at the time of our nation's birth, they were in their heyday, and it wasn't clear a mere president could rival the world's royalty and dignity and gravitas. But Americans, having been handed the gift of the presidency, never doubted it. That's because the president is a product of themselves in a way no king or potentate or even prime minister could ever be. That is one reason why the American presidency stirs so much interest, respect, and affection from the broad populace, and why, perhaps, so many Americans have always been captivated by the White House rating game. Thus, the rating game is more than just a beguiling diversion. It actually can tell us something about how and why presidents succeed or fail, how they deflect or get crushed by history, and the dynamics that bring forth those rare leaders of destiny. I will seek in this volume to put forth my own thoughts and observations, whatever their merits, about how the country's presidential politics has unfolded over the centuries. I do so fully in the rating game spirit and the spirit of Twain's observation about differences of opinion, which he said that it's a difference of opinion that makes horse races. Hence, if your views diverge significantly from those contained in this book, relax. As I say, the great White House rating game is ongoing and endless and open to everyone. Want to play?